Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Law of Attraction, and it is part of God's Laws series. It was presented in Gothenburg, Sweden on the 8th of July 2012. This is Session 2.
How are you all today on this lovely Sunday afternoon? It's a beautiful day, isn't it? Yeah. Are your summers generally like this? This is your summer, average summer weather? Yeah. This is our, we were saying this is our nice winter's day at home. So, yeah. Yeah. Well, I thought what we'd do today, firstly, Anna has written up here the contact details. There's a group of people who have been meeting fairly regularly in Gothenburg, isn't there? And discussing principles of divine truth and so forth. And so Anna has written those details on the board for any of you who wish to participate in that group. Does it meet once a week or once a fortnight? Or
Once a month.
Once a month, around about, yeah. So, yeah. And so they're the contact details. The other thing is that Anna does have a copy, which I'm updating tonight, of all of the material that we've presented on a hard disk drive. And she is willing also to copy that all of that material. If you give her a hard disk drive, she's willing to copy all of that material for you. So that's her email address there. And if you want to contact her and find out address to send it, and she'll send it back to you, or deliver it back to you if you're living locally. And that's a great way of getting all the material that's on YouTube and all the material that's on our website. And in fact, our entire website's on the disk as well. So you can actually run from the disk our entire website almost. And only the new things that we update on the website won't be on the disk that you have. So there's the contact details. Everyone who wants to write that down, written that down. And welcome to those of you who are fresh today. From our discussion yesterday was about the law of attraction. So what we're going to do in the first half of this afternoon is discuss a bit more about the law of attraction that we missed out on yesterday. And then what I would like to do after the break, where we have something to eat, after the break we will perhaps have it open for you to ask any questions that you want to ask of any nature, not just about the law of attraction, but of any questions you would like to ask, and I'll do my best to answer those questions. So everyone got that? So you want to take that photo of that? Yeah, that's a good idea. It's a fast way, isn't it? Okay. Okay. So we were continuing with this discussion, the law of attraction. I would like to first discuss with you a little bit about what God's intentions are when God is dealing with each of us individually. You see, from God's perspective, we are all His children, and so therefore He is very, very interested in each one of us. He is so interested in each one of us that He knows exactly everything possible about you. He knows right down to the cellular level and even deeper everything about you. He knows what you think. He knows how you feel. She knows what you desire. And she also knows the errors that are inside of you and where they came from, who created them, everything. In fact, God knows far more about you than you know about yourself. Also, we have in the spirit world many sincere and loving spirits who surround us, trying to influence us positively. And those sincere and loving spirits generally also know many more things about you than you know yourself. Many of them were even present at your birth, and they were present at your conception. They even know what happened in terms of the emotions that your mum and dad had at the time you were conceived and at the time you were born and all those kind of things, things that many of us really do not know much about. And so they are very, very interested in us far more interested in us than probably most of us are aware. And they know some basic truths about your nature. And they know in particular this basic truth about your nature. There is the real you that God created. This is the personality, if you like, that you can discover about yourself. Then there is what they see as the injured you. And if we just, instead of saying you, it's a bit sort of impersonal, isn't it? Sort of like pointing fingers at other people all the time. Let's make it the real me and the injured me. And then there's what they also see, God and these other spirits who are sincere and loving see us doing as well. They see that we create a facade, me, that we have done that as well. We create a facade. The person that we want to believe we are, or that we want everybody else to believe that we are, that we're really not. Right? Now, why have I raised these three selves, if you like, the three yous or the three selves, if you could call it that? And I've given a talk about this subject you can download. So these is the three, I call it the three selves or selves. And why have I raised that as in this discussion of the law of attraction? Well, God created the law of attraction for the soul law of attractions, so that we could get rid of the facade and also eventually get rid of all of the injuries and eventually become the real you, the real self. That's what God created us to be, the real self. And so every single thing about this law of attraction that operates upon your soul, which is the most powerful operation that it has upon individuals, is to focus us on removing these things from us and eventually honing us down to being the person that we were created to be. And that person actually is also going to be the best person we could ever be. Right. Now, if you think about it, while we attempt to hold on to the facade, or while we hold on to the injuries without having a strong desire to let them go, we are not working with God in any way to get back to our real self. And while we're doing that, we're actually opposing our own happiness. Because true happiness is only going to result in that column. That's the time when we're going to be sincerely happy, when we're being our real self all the time without any limitations. But we believe, generally, that we can be happy here. That's what we believe, that we can be happy here. And unfortunately, it is not true. You cannot be happy there, even though you'd like to believe you could be happy there. You cannot be happy there. So what God is constantly trying to do is to firstly break down ourself so that we end up with the real self that God created us to be. He's trying to help us get rid of both the facade that we have created. So this facade we have created. And he's also trying to help us get rid of the injuries that our environment and particularly our parents created. So this is the self that our environment created or wanted us to be. And God wants us to get back to what God created. Can you see that? Now, what I would like to do today during this discussion is I would like to help you through some examples. I'd like to help you through some examples that will help you expose within yourself how much you want to hold on to this person, the person you created. Right? And the problem with holding on to this person is that we will never become the person God created. while we're holding on to the person we create. And often we created this person to avoid those things. We hold on to this person to avoid what our environment created that is inside of us. And when you think about it, most of us, when we start going through this process of realizing who we are often initially very resistive to seeing who we are, because we believe that if we're not this person, the facade person who we created, then it means that we're this person, the injured person that our environment created. And we don't conceive that there is a third possibility, this possibility, in that place. We are so afraid that if we don't hold on to this, that we'll become this permanently, that we never conceive that we can be this, the real happy self that God created. Right? But God knows that we can be this. Even when we are not aware, God knows that we can be this. And so God has constructed the universe for you to become this. So every law that God created that operates upon your soul was purposefully created by God in order for you to become this. Right? So every time you work against becoming this, you're working against every law that operates upon your soul, which doesn't seem very productive if you think about it. Now, another thing I'd like to point out too is related to that in terms of the law of attraction, and that is to do with awareness. I'd like to discuss with you the principle of awareness. We can draw two columns. There are the things in ourselves that we see, and there are the things in ourselves that are unseen. In other words, we are unaware of them, completely unaware. All right? And then there are the things in ourselves that we see, or even that we think we see. Yeah. Now, if you think about it, if we knew everything about ourselves and we had a sincere desire to change anything in ourselves that was out of harmony with the real self, the self that God created us to be, then we would already be perfect. And not only would we already be perfect, you know, in terms of the person we are, we'd be perfect in our body. We'd be perfect in our, you know, we wouldn't age, we wouldn't get sick. We would be perfect in every relationship. We'd probably be with our soulmate, and we knew that we know who that is, and we'd be with them probably, unless they resisted that relationship. We would see everything. Now, the fact is that the majority of people on earth are not living that life. So that means there must be a lot in this list. A lot of things within us that are unloving, because it's all about growing in love as well, that we cannot see, or even that we believe are loving when they're actually unloving. There must be a lot, because if there wasn't a lot, none of us would grow old, none of us would get sick, right? We would have a life that's happy all the time, that we wouldn't have any problems, that we'd attract a lot of friends and loving people around us as a result. So it's interesting when we have a discussion about the law of attraction, often people raise issues and questions with me, and I then raise something that they cannot see. And when they can't see it, they then assume that it means that it's not there and that I'm wrong. Right? Now, you've probably even noticed that in your interactions with other people. When somebody comes along for a particular help to you, how many times have you told them, well, I feel it's this, and they don't even see it, right? It's sometimes very difficult, isn't it, to see your own issues, to see what's really going on inside of yourself. And we must understand that there must also be a long list of things that we cannot see if we're not perfect and if we're not staying young and if we're not, you know, feeling good all the time and we're not happy all the time and we're not having a life that's just living in our desire all the time, then there must be a lot of things we don't see, because that's what God created our life to be. God created us to live in our desire all the time, be happy all the time, to enjoy our relationships all the time. God, that's how God designed us, in fact. And God designed the whole universe to help us be that as well. And the fact is, and I know it's difficult for many of us to trust that God designed that, by the way, because we see a world that's very different to that, don't we? So we see a world where very few people actually seem to have a happy life. Very few people seem to have a really happy relationship. Very few people really seem to, you know, be growing young again. In fact, you know, when we look around us, you know, everyone we see pretty much looks like they're growing old, and we see them 10 years later and they've got more wrinkles and they look a bit older and they're usually a bit more unhealthy and so forth. And this is all evidence around us that there's a different reality. And so what we tend to do is we tend to accept that as God's reality, as if God created it. But I'm saying God never created it like that. There's got to be things inside of us that we don't see that are creating it like that. And those things are all unloving. They're all something to do with love, in other words. There's always something to learn about love. And that when we learn that particular thing about love, there will always be a result, a positive result, once we learn that thing about love. So the problem we face is that there are many things that we see, you know, about ourselves. Some of those things we might see, we would classify in our facade as good. Sometimes some of the things we think are good are actually not good. So in other words, we might, for example, see that occasionally we get angry, but we think we're justified getting angry at those occasions because, you know, somebody hurt you or somebody was unjust with you, and that's the time to be angry. And we believe that, right? So there are things that we see that we believe are actually good that might not be loving, right? But then there are also things that we see that we internally generally view as bad, right? And therefore we have a lot of judgment about them. We don't really like to see them. You know, we see them, but we don't like to see them. It's like looking in the mirror in the morning, noticing that you've just got a new pimple on your face, and the instant reaction is, if I can't get rid of this straight away, this is not good, right? And so we see that pimple as a bad thing now, and it's going to spoil the rest of our day because people will notice it and so forth. And so what we try to do is get rid of it. And when we're not successful getting rid of it, then we feel quite disappointed. And it's very much the same with our emotions, our bad feelings. We try to do exactly the same as that. We try to get rid of it straight away. And if we can't get rid of it straight away, then we try to ignore it and make out it's not even there anymore. And this is what we do, even with the things we see. But what do we do with the things we don't see? Well, with the things we don't see, we are in complete denial of. We go into complete denial. Now, God is trying to get you out of denial every single moment of your life. So while you're desperately holding on to denial about something, God is trying to do exactly the opposite. God is trying to expose that thing while you're trying to deny it. Does that make sense? That's God's intention. Because remember, God's intention is to get you back to your real self. You're never going to get back to the real self unless you see or have awareness of what's really inside. And you're also never going to get back to your real self if you see something as good when it's bad, or you see something as bad when it's good. You're never going to get back to your real self if you do those things. And so it's going to require a growth in awareness. And a growth in awareness is always going to be challenging, isn't it? How can you grow without being challenged? That's very difficult. For most of us, we don't initially have a strong desire for growth. We have a strong desire for what? Most of the time? To stay the same. Particularly when we get things just seemingly nice, then we stay the same. We want to stay the same. We don't want to grow beyond that. And we have a lot of fear as a result. So if we look at what God is trying to do in terms of our life, This is what God is attempting to do with us. Through this law of attraction, God is attempting to get us from denial into, initially into awareness, to help us to become aware, and then into the emotions of awareness, which usually begin with anger-based emotions, and then into, usually there's a layer of addictions that we need to then address, and then into our fear-based emotions, and then into our grieving-based emotions, which are the actual, these emotions are the healing emotions. These are the emotions that will heal us. That's what God's attempting to do with us, every single moment. Now, for the majority of us, we don't actively engage God in this process. In other words, we don't necessarily trust that God exists, or if we do believe that God exists, we don't trust that God actually has any interest in us personally. For many of us, we don't feel that. Or we don't feel a strong connection with God, and we have stronger connections with other beings, other spirits or people on earth that we have stronger connections with, because we are often trying to avoid our connection with God, right? So what would you do if you had somebody you loved who's trying to avoid every interaction with you? What would you do? It'd be pretty hard, wouldn't it? Like, if you love them and you'd like to interact with them and they don't want to have any interactions with you, what would you try? You'd want to know still what's going on in their life, wouldn't you? So you'd want to be able to find that out somehow. And you'd like to be able to interact with them somehow. So what has to happen if we decide to not interact directly with God is God's got to use other things in the universe that we actually like interacting with to actually help us go through this process. So in other words, when you attract a relationship, you obviously like the person you're in a relationship with, at least for a while. Yeah. And so therefore, God would love to help that person help you go through this process if you don't want to go through it in an active way with God directly. Or every one of us has a mum and a dad or a sister and a brother generally, or a child or some other persons that we're friends with. So we have interactions that are human relationships. Now, God, any person, any one of those persons who's willing to go along with some of God's promptings, God will try to help you go through this process with. Does that make sense? God's constantly trying to do this all the time. So there are two ways we can engage the law of attraction. One way is by engaging this law directly with the creator of the law, which is God, and this is you, right? And you can engage this law in an active way with God. And when I say in an active way, you can actually communicate with God and feel, and it has to be via feelings. You have to be sincere with this. You can't do it with your head without your heart being involved with God. So you can actually begin to communicate with God to help bring things to you that help you get out of denial into awareness and into your emotions of anger, into your addictions so that you release them, and into your fears so you release them. And eventually you get to your fears and your grief, and when they're gone, then you can be a very happy person once those fears and grief is gone out of you. So that's one way you can engage this law. The other way you can engage the law, or the other way you engage the law automatically if you do not involve God, is around God there are many spirits. Now, some of these spirits are what I would call very happy people who are connected to God. So there's God here, but you're not engaging God directly. But these are spirits who engage God. And then there are also a heap of spirits who do not engage God. In other words, they're just the same as the person who doesn't want to engage God on earth for whatever reason. So they don't engage God. But God can still engage them. Right? And then there are people on earth who want to engage God. Right? And then there are people on earth who don't want to engage God. And then there's you. Now, who is God going to try to use to help engage you in this process of going through denial into awareness and down through the emotions to become your real self? You can see that God is going to engage firstly these groups of people, the spirits and the people on earth, so these are on earth, who actually want to engage God. He's going to try to do it through them first. Would make sense, wouldn't it? And then if that doesn't work, he's going to help them, help these people do it with you as well, to get you through this denial into your awareness and your anger, so, and into your addictions and fear and grief eventually. So you have either ahead of you the choice where you can simply engage the law of attraction with one person, or you can engage the law of attraction with hundreds and hundreds of thousands of millions of people, right, through a process that isn't always as pleasant as engaging it with the one person. But either way, God's going to be leading you through this law because the law exists. It's like the law of gravity. It exists and it operates. So it's going to always exist and it's going to always operate anyway. And you have a choice as to how you're going to engage it. So if you think about it with the law of gravity, you have your choice of how you engage it, don't you? So you can decide to walk on the ground and be pretty safe most of the time, or you could decide to get up on a 10-story building and try to walk on air off the building and see how the law engages you then, couldn't you? The law will engage you then in a much more harsh manner than when it did when you were walking on the ground. Is that not true? And it's a very similar process when we engage this law of attraction without any awareness. You see, when we engage it without awareness, there's a higher likelihood of us making either painful mistakes in our life or having unpleasant surprises, a lot of unpleasant surprises, in fact, in our life. If we engage it in a more active way, there's a higher likelihood of almost everything happening in a almost a pleasant way, even with people who may be not connected with God or unloving, we still might be engaging it in a more pleasant way. So that's the choice that we face with the law of attraction. We face the choice of either engaging it actively in a knowing manner or engaging it with no awareness in a manner that where we want to maintain our ignorance, but it's still going to happen anyway. That's the reality of all of God's laws. So I don't know about you, but I feel the choice with God is a much more simple choice. Once I've engaged that choice, things go a lot more smoother in your life, in fact. And what I would like to do today now is show you how to engage this law with God. Does that make sense? And you will find other people will be involved in it, but in the process of engaging it with God, there is a lot of very direct feedback that you can get very instantly in your life. But for us to understand anything about the law of attraction, we must understand one primary thing that I've yet to mention about it, and that is this. We already have everything we truly want. This is going to be very hard to accept. For many of you, it's going to be very hard to accept. And many of you say no, but trust me, it's going to be very hard for you to accept this basic truth. But if you can accept this very basic truth, you will understand the law of attraction much better. Absolutely everything that's happening to you right now is exactly what your soul wants to happen to you right now. everything. So all those negative events that you yell about and scream about and carry on about and say, why is this happening to me? They're all happening right now because you want them to happen to you right now. But remember, it's to do with your soul, which remember from yesterday was your... What did it include? Your feelings, your emotions, yeah? Beliefs, desires, so emotions and so forth, right? So this is your soul, and what I'm saying is that everything you already have right now in your life, everything that your soul in its current state wants. And people go, but I'm sick. How did my soul want that? I don't want to be sick. You know, like I go to the doctor to stop being sick. How can you say that my soul wants sick? Or you might have had an accident of some kind. How can you say my soul wanted an accident? I don't want an accident. Like, that's the last thing I want. You might have had a friend die last week. How many of you wanted that? And I'm saying even those events are exactly what your soul wanted. It's an interesting concept, isn't it? So how can we say that? Well, you see, these events must occur in order for us to get out of this state.
Just wondered if there was a Swedish translation for denial.
Is there a Swedish translation for denial? I won't repeat it. if you can say it into the microphone, so that
I just thought it might help some people in the audience.
Oh, I've got the microphones. Yeah. Can I need someone to actually help me testing to pass these around for your questions? Would someone on this side like to do that? Thank you. And we'll pass it to Anna first so she can say that word again. Denial. So
förnekelse.
Yep. And awareness.
Medvetenhet.
And then the emotions.
Ilska.
Addictions. Remember, they're also emotional addictions. They're not just physical.
Beroenden.
Okay.
Rädsla, sorg.
Okay, so they are the different stages that we're going to go through, those particular words. So if we look at the denial, what God is trying to do is to get us out of denial, like I've just stated. And so we are already attracting everything right now. Everything that is happening in our life right now is there to expose our denial. And so anything that's negative, for example, that is happening in our life right now, is there to expose our denial. That's the primary purpose. Does that make sense? It's all happening to show you something. Now, some of the things you're denying, you actually like denying. Yeah? Okay. Can I illustrate some of those things as an idea? How many of you are not in a relationship, a sexual relationship? Okay, so it must be half the audience. That's quite a lot, actually. Okay, I'm suggesting to you that you want it that way. Is that the case? How many of you can see you want it that way? About half of those people. How many of you believe that I'm just talking total rubbish now? You can be honest. You say, I do want a relationship. I do want a relationship. But you see, there's something in your soul that is repelling a relationship. Something in your soul is repelling it. And so the fact that you don't have a relationship is because there's something in your soul that's repelling a relationship. Does that make sense? There's something there that's creating that state. So it's interesting in Australia that we have a lot of people come up to us, particularly early days in our presentation, saying, I really want to have a relationship and I just can't seem to make a relationship work. And you say, well, you obviously don't want a relationship. Yes, I do. How can you say that I don't want a relationship? I definitely want a relationship. And that's what I feel is very much strong denial about what emotions are present about a relationship. You see, if we're not engaged in a relationship right now, there are emotional reasons why we are not. Right? And there's 6.5, nearly 7 billion people on the planet from whom you can choose to have a relationship. So obviously if you don't have one, there's something going on. Does that make sense? Now, I'm not saying that everyone has to have a relationship, but what I'm saying is that if you want one and you don't have one, then there must be something going on. There's enough people in the world to have a relationship with, so at least of some kind, and so there must be something happening. Now, it could be, couldn't it, that you're waiting for your soulmate. How long have you been waiting for your soulmate, for some of you? Can I ask that question? How many of you have been waiting for 5 years for your soulmate? Yeah. How many of you don't even want your soulmate, to be frank? Nobody. How many of you are with your soulmate? All right, so very few. So the rest of you, these questions apply to a lot, right? How many of you say you want your soulmate? You know you want your soulmate. Now, how many of you who know you want your soulmate are with your soulmate? Not very many. Okay, so there must be something that's repelling your soulmate. Is that not the case? Because otherwise, if you really want something, and this is something I said to somebody earlier and just before we began, is that if you really have a strong desire for something, then you'll create it. So you've got to look at the fact that if you're not creating it, there mustn't be a strong desire. Now, what causes a suppression of desire? Well, fear is the primary emotion, causes a suppression of desire. And what do we do with our fear? We create addictions to suppress our fear. Right, so our addictions are actually supporting us not having strong desires and therefore not being able to create. And so what we need to be aware of is that we already have exactly what we want. And if you think about it, what we have now right now is generally a lot of addictions getting met. Now, for some of us, those addictions are: I like to have complete autonomy in my life, and I don't like the idea of having to reference another person in order to do something. You see, in a partnership, you might have to do that, mightn't you? You might have to actually communicate together and actually decide to do some things together that you might not be able, that you would have, that, and so you might not be able to do some things that you could have done if you were single. Is that not true? And so we choose the addiction. You choose to remain single so that we get to do the other things that we want to do. That's what we think. And then we wait for that ideal person to come along who's going to meet every addiction of mine, right? And then when that person comes along, I'll call them my soulmate. Right? That's what we often do. And so what we finish up doing is that here I am, you know, I'm ploughing along with my life single, waiting for the ideal person who will meet all of my addictions. And when she comes along and I engage her. But unfortunately, because she's meeting my addictions, sooner or later it's going to feel quite bad. And this is why eventually the relationship will just break down and eventually discard generally. It's rare for an addiction relationship to last forever. In fact, the reality is, if it lasts while you're alive, it'll definitely die once you pass. Does that make sense? Yep. So these addiction-based relationships, God also wants to confront. God created one relationship, the soulmate relationship, where the two halves of the same person come together in the end. There's one being, one soul in two bodies. That's the relationship God created. And you can't choose your soulmate. It's already chosen for you. How many of you don't like that idea? You've got to be honest, you see. Many of you don't like that idea. What if your soulmate was a murderer? Would you like it that he's a murderer? What if he was a rapist sitting in jail at the moment? Would you like that? right? So you've got to be honest about these things, you see. And we're often not honest, and we tell ourselves a lot of lies. We tell ourselves a lot of falsehoods because we don't want to go through the emotion of it. By the way, as an aside, I don't know if you ever would get this movie, but it's in English. It's a movie called Timer. It's actually about a lot. It raises a lot of issues about soulmate relationships and meeting them and when you're going to meet them and all these different emotions. It's quite an interesting. It's a comedy, but you could sometimes say it's a little black comedy. It's a pretty good movie to see.
Earlier you talked about the three selves, the real you that's created by God and the injured you that's created by the environment and the facade you that's created by yourself.
Yep.
But then in essence what you're saying through this is that the injured you is also created by yourself.
No, the injured you is, partially. The injured you in the initial instance is created by your environment, but then you make choices which often injure yourself. And so you often build upon the injured you that your parents or your environment created, and then through the actions you take, you personally injure yourself even further. And many of us do that quite frequently. So by the time we become an adult, we're not just now our injuries aren't just the sum total of our environmental injuries, but they include the injuries we've taken by making choices that are unloving ourselves, and they add to the experience of our injured self. So for example, when you're a child, for example, there might have been an unhealthy relation set up with your father, as an example. And in that unhealthy relationship, it got established. And then once it got established, it then defined the rest of your relationships. And so you attracted men when you were a teenager who were also similar in their injuries to your father. And then you chose to be with them, and in the process of choosing to be with them, probably the relationship broke up at some point with exactly the same issues generally that you have with your father. And then you had a further injury now of not only of it being with your father, but also with that person, and then with another person, and then with another person. And that's a way that we act upon the injured self and eventually create more injuries within ourselves. So I'm not saying that the injured self is totally the responsibility of our parents, because the reality is we do make choices ourselves. There are many people who make loving choices even though their parents treated them unlovingly. So we have the capacity to not injure ourselves further, but unfortunately the reality is that the majority of people finish up injuring themselves further by not dealing with their injured self. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah. The second question is, I don't know if you use the term victim mentality, but I think there's been times in my life where I've had a victim mentality. And what would you say that is? Is that addictions to negative emotions then, where you like the self-pity, or I don't know how you would explain that?
It's an addiction to not taking personal responsibility, actually. So whenever we portray ourselves as being the victim, we're firstly not honouring the fact that there are certain things certainly that happened to us when we were a child that we were not responsible for. In other words, we're not to blame for them happening because somebody else did it to us. But the reality is we are the only person who can be responsible to release the emotion of it. So when I say not taking responsibility, what I mean is we don't have to take responsibility for the bad things that happened to us when we were little, but we do need to take responsibility for the emotions we have about the bad things that happened to us when we were little. Do you see the difference? And the majority of us don't do that. The majority of us want the other person who harmed us to take responsibility for the emotions we have. And the unfortunate thing of that is that no matter who hurt us, they will never be able to feel our feelings about that hurt. Does that make sense to everyone? And so what we finish up doing is we try to make other people feel our bad feelings about our hurt, but it's never going to be successful because the only person who can release them is ourselves. So we need to learn to take responsibility. But when we go into the victim mode, what we do then is we're wanting someone else to take responsibility for how we feel rather than actually just feeling how we feel, the causal emotion of what actually happened to us. And it's a great way of avoiding acting as well. When we go into a victim, we don't have to act. We don't have to decide. We don't have to make choices. And God's all about helping us make choices. So when we choose to not make any more choices, choices are going to be forced upon us in that position, because the world by nature is going to force choices on us. But we often then try to withdraw from the world, and we try to go into this victim place where we try to make other people responsible for the choices we make. And to be honest, even the choices that other people made that affect us, we still have to bear the responsibility of the feeling of that, because nobody else can feel what we feel, actually. They can sense what we feel, they can feel the emotion of it, but they can't actually release it. They can't actually go through the process of getting rid of it for you. Only you can do that. And this is something God knows. So God knows that all of this grief that's inside of you has been generally initially created by other people, and then through your own actions you added to it generally, right? But this grief, God knows, is the healing emotion. Like, in the end, that's where God wants you to be, to get into that grief and release it, just like a sobbing child would release the grief inside of themselves. That's where God wants us to be. But we are so geared, from a society perspective and also from an individual perspective, because of the way our parents brought us up, to deny as much grief as possible and deny as much fear as possible and live in this area here, where we live in either our addictions, and then when our addictions don't get met, we go into anger or frustration or annoyance. And then if we don't go into anger because we're not allowed to, we go into no awareness, or what we try to do is, you know, try to blanket completely. We go into almost complete denial. And we try to make out that we're not even aware then of what's inside of us. And that's the main reason why today on the planet there's huge amount of depression. Because when we suppress our anger and we suppress the deeper emotions, which is by the time we've got the anger, we were already suppressing a lot of emotion. And if we suppress our anger even further, we're not allowed to be angry in any way either, then what we do is we go into denial. And now while we're suppressing all of our soul, what's happening is that we are now probably going to go into this state of depression, which is really a state of suppressed rage with the world. It's the greatest victim we can become. Does that make sense? And this is why depression is such a popular thing, particularly in the Western world, because we've just become so frustrated and not allowed to even feel our frustration. You're not allowed to, even in your own home. You'll find this in your processing emotionally. You'll find if you make too much noise in your own home when nobody else is there, your neighbours will ring the police, because they'll wonder what's happening to you. So when you're processing rage, for example, in your own home with nobody else there, and nobody else is getting dumped upon and nobody else is getting hurt, you still generally, from a society perspective, are not allowed to do it. We actually had in Australia one time where 5 people in a group started getting in a real rage, and we had to send them outside, and they went outside and yelled and screamed in the outside. It was in a 5-acre property. The neighbours heard them yelling and screaming and rang the police. The police came to the seminar, right, and actually said to me that I should control the people who were outside screaming, right? And I wasn't even my home, by the way. I was visiting another person's home, and so it wasn't up to me to do that. But I was presenting the seminar, of course. So That is an illustration of how far society will go to attempt to shut you down from experiencing your own emotions. And it's just very, very common. Yep. If we have the microphone. You'll need to take the microphone off of Anna, and somebody else will need to do that for. So Anna needs to stay there. Thank you.
I have a grandchild who is 2 years old. Mm-hmm. And when she get born, she had a tremendous scream, the doctor said that you will got tinnitus from her, because she's screaming from the start.
Yeah.
And now and then, and just now, she has been starting again, screaming so much.
Yep.
And I haven't been with her for a few weeks now, but I heard her mother talking about that this has become a problem for them.
Mm-hmm.
So I really want to ask you what way can I help them to let this scream coming out and not stop it?
Well, the child's in anger, yes?
Yes.
And therefore the child's not getting its addictions met.
No.
And that's why it's going into anger.
Mm.
So what we need to do is stop the child from ever having one of those addictions met ever again.
Mm.
When you do that, the child will go from its screaming into its grief immediately, pretty much.
Mm.
The fastest way to do that is whenever the child screams, all you do is you hold the child's arms and legs and just sit the child on your lap and you don't let the child move.
Okay.
And you just hold it and hold it and hold it and hold it and hold it. And eventually the child will go into this kicking rage,
mm-hmm.
where they want to get out of your grip, and you keep holding them and you keep holding them. They'll try to bite you and they'll try to do all sorts of things. You keep holding them and you keep holding them. And eventually they'll get into their grief.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as they get into their grief, now they are in their causal emotion as to what causes them to scream.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can just hold them and let them cry.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll stop screaming. Now, if you did that every single time the child screamed, whether it was a spirit influencing the child to scream or the child was screaming because of its own addiction, it didn't matter. Sooner or later, within a few days, in fact, the child will completely stop doing that. They will never scream again. Right? And that's a loving way of addressing the addiction. Does that make sense? And they could still scream about other things, but they will definitely never scream about that particular addiction again. Yeah? Mary, you want to...
No, I just had a question about whether it was since the child was born that she was screaming.
Yeah, the first moment when she came out, she had this tremendous big screaming.
Yep. Yeah.
So I think it was something happening before.
Before, yeah, with her mum and dad. Yeah.
Yeah.
I just wondered about.
And is it a rage-based screaming or a fear-based screaming?
High C.
Does it feel like the child's enraged or does it feel like the child's afraid?
More enraged than...
Right. Mm. So it's a spirit overcloaking the child.
Mm.
The same applies. Spirits hate to be restricted.
Mm.
And as soon as they're restricted, they generally go into rage and then eventually they leave the child and then the child's left with just the grief. Yeah.
Mm.
But the parents have to also look at something here too.
Yeah,
So the parents need to examine how they respond to rage in other people.
Mm. Yeah? Because her father is had a depression, so I can...
Yep. Mm. I find here in Sweden, many of you are conciliatory to a person's rage. You're conciliatory. That means you pander to their rage. You what's another word?
You comply with it.
Is that the right word for... I'm looking for a word that shows that you try to make the person who's angry with you calm down.
Yes. We try to get rid of it.
You try to make them calm down so they're no longer angry.
You follow the orders of the anger.
In other words, you pander or support their anger and you actually... what you're actually doing when you do that is you're supporting their addiction to go to anger. Because what you're teaching them, whenever you do whatever they want when they're angry, you're teaching them that anger is the way for them to get what they want. Does that make sense? Many of you have done this with your own children. You've taught them that it's okay to get angry because angry is the only time you're going to finish up getting what you want. And so eventually they get angry a lot. Just to get what they want, right? And that's an addiction. There's an addiction in you. What's the addiction in you? You're afraid of anger and you don't want to feel how terrified you are of somebody's anger. You also probably want to be liked, and when the person's angry, you feel unliked, you feel unloved, and so you want to pander to their anger. You want to do things for their anger. And as a result of that, you are in the addiction of giving to a person who's angry, and the person who's angry then learns that their anger is the way to get exactly what they want. And their anger is already covering an addiction that they have of wanting to get what they want in some ways, and all you're doing is supporting that, right? And this is the problem, is that many of these emotions we do not realise we are actually supporting. So we get a law of attraction event come to us that our soul attracts, like a screaming child in this case. The screaming child is exposing a couple of things. Firstly, the child is probably overcloaked by a spirit. If the child began screaming in anger from the time it was born, then it has to have got that feeling from somewhere. And what do the parents do with this anger? This tells me that the parents themselves are probably people who conciliatory or pander or do whatever the angry person wants. And there must be a reason why they do that, that they need to address. If they hold on to the child and do not let her, like, express her rage, she's allowed to express her rage, but they restrict her from harming anybody in expressing her rage, she will go even into more rage. And if they don't smack the child, they just keep holding her and they just keep being patient and they connect to their own feelings about how much they want to let go, and they still hold on, and they allow the child to go through the process, eventually the child will disconnect from the spirit who causes it to be in a rage, and the child itself will go through whatever the addiction is, you know, towards rage, which is all about control. The whole reason why we get addicted to rage is because we want control, and we want control of a family in this case. And she'll let go of that particular addiction, and then everything will be quite nice and calm and peaceful. Now, we've actually recommended that many times, and there's a couple of families in Australia who try that in a sincere way. We met one family who had three children who were spirit overcloaked pretty much the whole time. She'd take them shopping and they'd wreck the shopping centre, and she'd take, you know, they'd be very noisy, and every time one of the parents started doing something they liked doing, one of the children would interrupt them and scream and yell and carry on, and then they'd go fighting each other as well whenever the parents were doing something they liked doing. And as a result of that, all of that, what happened was that we finish up suggesting just hold them. Within 2 days, the spirits who were influencing those children had already stepped away from those children, and it was like meeting the children for the very first time. Like, you got their true nature and their true personality, and there was no smacking involved, but there was the need to address the control. Now, when you think about it, what God is attempting to do with us is exactly the same. All of us, with regard to all of the things that we are unaware of or in denial of, we are all like spoilt children, where we want the thing we want, and we don't want to let it go. And God's trying to, with these laws, God holds us and shows us through the attraction that we, whatever we attract, God's showing us what the problem is. And if we allow ourselves to become aware of what's happening to us in our life, and we're honest about it, we need to be honest about it. So many times I see people definitely not honest about it. So, for example, the earlier question I asked, when we put up their hands and said, who would like to have a relationship, who's not in a relationship and who would like to have a relationship? And the truth is that anybody who answers affirmative to that is not being honest with themselves. Right? How many of you get sick? How many of you have been sick the last year? Yeah? Okay. Well, sickness, any sickness like a cold, a flu, depression, anything that is medically diagnosed or can be medically diagnosed, how many of you have been sick? There's a lot more, you see. See how the first question, not many honest. You understand? We are automatically in denial, and we don't want to even admit to ourselves that we're there. And then when I'm specific about the question and we ask all the details, we go, well, most of the audience put up their hand. Yes, now we're being truthful. When we're truthful, we have an opportunity to change. If we're in denial, you have no opportunity to change. So God's always, through this law, trying to get you to be honest with yourself. Does that make sense? That's God's focus. God wants to see this honesty with yourself, warts and all, as the saying goes in English, like all of your flaws, all of your flaws. God wants you to be able to see them at least. Now, we spend a lot of our time denying our flaws. You know why? Because we're so invested in the facade. We like the face we put on in front of the mirror. In a lot of ways, we're all wearing makeup all the time, even to ourselves. We cover over what we are. And we're constantly trying to do this, and this is not very good for our spiritual progression at all. God's trying to do the opposite with us. God's trying to help us become our real self. And to become our real self, we're going to have to go through the facade, through the injuries to our real self. Most of us want to go over the facade and over the injuries to our real self. We want to skip around the injuries and get to our real self. It is not going to be possible. Not going to be possible. So, yes?
AJ, you told about if an angry child, what to do. But if it's angry adults, what to do? You can't hold it. What to do?
Well, the best way to handle an angry adult is actually to have four people hold them down and actually just hold them. That's the best possible way to...
Particular person or for the...
For every person who's angry, yes. Okay. However, as you correctly say, in practice it's pretty hard to do because you would actually need four or five people strong enough to hold them down to do that, wouldn't you?
But it is the best way, you think?
Of course it's the best way. They're being a child, just like a child. They're having a tantrum, just like a child. How do we handle tantrums? The same way as we would a child. That would be the best way.
Okay. And another question.
Can I go further with the answer, though? Obviously, in practice, that's a bit difficult if you're one person living with a person who's angry and they're angry all the time. Then that means you'd have to ring up your friends and get five of you over and all hold them down. And that, obviously, after a while, would get a bit annoying and frustrating and obviously wouldn't be too practical. So what do you do? The answer is you always leave an angry person. You always leave them. It doesn't matter if they're living in your house, you leave them. If they won't leave your house and you own your house, you get the police to come and take them away. See, I'm pretty firm with anger. In Australia, we have the God's Way of Love learning centres that we're creating, and in the centres, what we're trying to do is encourage every team leader, every time somebody's angry, they get sent home. Every time they get angry, they're sent home. They're not allowed to engage the process in the audience. So in other words, they're not allowed to dump their anger on another person. They're allowed to go out and feel their anger, that's fine. But they're not allowed to project their anger onto another person. If they do that, they're sent home. If they refuse to go home, we'll call the police. So they're forced to go home. Microphone. Can we wait for the microphone? It's just behind you.
Excuse me. Do you send them home without any explanation about this process?
Yes.
Why?
Because it's not my responsibility to tell them why they're angry.
Mm-hmm. But to handle it and to get rid of it.
They have a lot of options to no longer be angry. Mm. They need to learn that anger is not... when you're angry, why would you demand help from another person when you're angry? To me, that's an addiction. Like, if you think you can get angrier than another person when they're helping you, then you're pretty off. You're pretty unloving and you need to address that. So I don't even now give anybody an explanation.
Right? Because if I met a person who's angry, I would say, I can see your anger.
Yep.
But you need to go through your anger and then find what you feel.
They don't
feel.
Need to do anything. Mm. In my opinion, they don't need to do anything. They can choose to do something, but they don't need to. But I'm not going to put up with them. Mm. Okay. Does that make sense? Mm. So I'm definitely not going to put up with them being angry in my presence.
But if you leave them and say, you can go home and stay there, but don't be angry in here. And Do you think they will find their way to get rid of their anger and go through this process?
Well, that's up to them.
Yeah.
It's not my responsibility. Mm. What's up to them is they need to go into awareness of what is creating their anger. And once they become aware of what's creating their anger, they will see that they're in an addiction of some kind. I've explained all of that to them previously. They all know that. So whenever they get angry, they need to be sent home because they're not getting that. What's the point of explaining anymore? They might as well just go home.
Mm-hmm. We're talking about two different persons. Because I'm thinking of a person who doesn't know about this.
Oh, even if a first person doesn't know that, I will still treat them in the same way.
Okay.
I don't deserve their anger, do you?
No.
Do you deserve anybody's anger? No. So why do you put up with their anger? You do. You do. The reality is you do put up with their anger, so you've got to ask yourself the question, why? What's your addiction to putting up with people's anger? Yeah. You know what sometimes it is? You get angry and you want other people to put up with you. Sometimes it's that. Sometimes that's the addiction, that you want them to put up with your anger, and so that means you're going to have to put up with their anger, if you're being fair. And so you feel that's the reason why. You don't want to be sent home when you're angry, and so you don't want to send anybody else home when they're angry. Does that make sense? That's another addiction. These are all addictions, you see, that eventually get confronted when we act in harmony with love. See, if we put up with people's rage all the time, then what we're doing is we're teaching them that anger is the way to actually live their life. Do you want to teach somebody? Do you want to be responsible for teaching somebody that? Well, I don't. I want to be responsible for teaching them that actually anger is a suppression, is the cause by them not having their addictions met. And I don't want to meet their addiction every time they go into anger. I don't want to be conciliatory and meet their addiction. I want them to go away from me. That's what I want. And if they're not willing to go away from me and they're in my home or they're in my environment that I have some control over, then I will make sure they go away from me by getting some police to come and take them away. And if I'm in their environment, I will leave immediately. I'll just walk out the door. It doesn't matter whether I've travelled overseas to see them. I'm walking out the door. Does that make sense? Yeah. So you see, if we don't if we're not pandering or constantly engaging a person's anger, then can you see the person is very rapidly going to see that their anger is not loving. But if I pander to their anger and do what their anger demands, then the person's not going to very rapidly see that what they're doing is unloving. They're going to think they should get away with it. I can't agree with that. We should never let another person who's angry get away with anything, right? And it doesn't matter even at threat to my own life. They're still not going to get away with it. That's the way it feels for me. Does that make sense? And when we do that, we are now helping the person themselves to get into their addiction and see what their addiction is, but we're also helping us ourselves to address our fear of other people's rage. So we're actually addressing two addictions in one. We're addressing their addiction to go into their rage and our addiction to pander or please a person who's angry. We're also addressing both of those things, which is wonderful. That means two people are benefiting from that interaction. Yeah?
I have two questions. You said you should hold a child for how long? In which age should you send them home?
You hold them for as long as it takes for them to get into their grief, and if that happens to be 5 hours, then you hold them for 5 hours.
Just, I mean, how old should they be when you don't hold them any longer?
As old as you can handle their body throwing them around.
Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, if you can handle your 10-year-old throwing his body around and still hold him, then I'd do it with a 10-year-old. Certainly.
Yeah. A friend of mine, she's working with small children, mm-hmm. and we have been talking about this.
Mm-hmm.
And she said that sometimes she really could feel that that's the right way to do it, to mm-hmm. hold them.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes she feels that it doesn't work. So is it What do you say about that?
It will always work.
It will always.
If you address as the adult your own addiction to what's happening, because remember it's a law of attraction event, so it actually involves you. If it's your child or a child in your care, then obviously there is something going on for you as to why this child is getting into their state of rage, right? And so what I'm suggesting is any child that's in a state of rage, if you hold them, you're now limiting the extent of the damage they can do in their rage, which is a loving thing to do, right? But the beauty of holding them is you've got to be present. If you're not present, this won't work. If you go out of your body, this will not work. You need to stay present in your body, feel your feelings, and hold them. Does that make sense? You have to be present. If you are present, you are loving somebody. Love will always overcome the problem if you're present. If you go out of your body, then you're not present and you're not loving somebody. And now, you know, the child's probably going to stay in that state for a longer period of time. And you're not gaining anything doing that. But if you're present and loving the child and speaking with the child while you're holding the child and explaining to the child why you're holding the child and telling them that their actions are unloving, and when they get angry, say that your anger is not loving, so I've just got to keep holding you, and you keep saying these things and explaining to them in the same voice that I'm doing it with you now, in a nice calm way, and you're not angry yourself and you're not frustrated yourself and you're not annoyed yourself, then this child will instantly be able to feel the love, even though it might take some time over that period for them to break into their emotion. They will be able to feel this love, and it will always work. It always works. Every child that I've done it with, it's worked. Right.
Thank you.
Yep.
I've been doing this with my daughter, who will turn 3 in mm-hmm. September. She's mm-hmm. still quite small, and I can confirm that a couple of minutes, and her rage turns into tears, and then she's like, "Oh, mommy, can we read that book?"
Yep.
But my question is, this was about she hurting her brother.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that kind of rage and wanting to control other people, that comes from me.
Mm-hmm.
So the
I
question
agree.
Is...
So if we can summarise, your child daughter hurting your child son
yes.
is an indication that rage exists in the women towards the men in the household.
Yes.
Does that make sense? Mm. And she is just reflecting that rage.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, and that's also, she might also under that influence have spirits with her that reflect this rage, and so she feels that she can hit her brother.
Yes.
Yes.
So... though I feel that I'm doing the loving thing in that moment, holding her, I kind of understand that. Or my question is, will that not keep coming back to her as long as I have it in myself?
Yes.
Okay.
You're right. Of course it will. You see, what the whole event is there is to help you become aware of the amount of anger you have that comes from the addictions you have with men.
Okay.
Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And so while it's great to stop it, you're not violently attacking the men, are you? You're not punching your husband in the face or you're kicking him or any of those kind of things, but your daughter is doing that with her brother. So she is becoming even more enraged than you are. Mm. With the man.
She's
so
more sincere, I would like.
She's more sincere about it.
So yes.
but the reality is that you've learned at least to act in a more loving way towards the opposite gender, and she needs to learn the same, whether the feelings are there or not.
Okay.
Right? But what we do need to do is address the feelings. And the only way to address her feelings is to start addressing yours. And so, yes, while you are resistive to your addictions and therefore still in a passive-aggressive or sometimes an aggressive rage with men, then you will continue...
to project...
Well, you will attract events with your daughter
yes.
where she
okay.
expresses that rage. Does that make sense?
Okay.
And the problem with that is that you will have to keep doing it and keep doing it and keep doing this holding thing realizing in the end that someone should come along and hold you, probably, and so that you can get rid of this rage that you have with men. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And if, and the beauty of engaging your daughter in this process is you'll go instantly into this, wow, I have this with men.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, you're having. I feel it. It's. Yep. It's direct. It's,
and the whole process with your daughter is helping you become aware of what is present within you about men and how much you would like to control them. And when you can't control them, you feel angry with them and what you'd like to do with them, even though you can't always do it, when you feel like they are out of control.
Yes.
Yes. And this is the way of exposing the underlying emotion within yourself. Yeah? Mm. And the key is now to go into... You know, you can see the addiction, so you have awareness now that whenever your addictions are not met, you go into anger with men, so you see that addiction. So now what you need to do is go in the opposite direction and start to feel some of the fear you have if you didn't have your addiction met. Okay. So when you didn't have your addiction met, how would you feel? So if the man doesn't come home and make you feel nice and safe and secure, how do you feel? If you want to go and do something and he doesn't let you go and do it, how do you feel? Right? And there's unloved emotions in there and then feelings of being controlled and so forth. And they all cover fears that you have. And the key is to allow yourself to get into those fears instead of staying in the addiction. If you stay in the addiction, your daughter will stay in her addiction. She will act out your addiction. She will hit her brother and you'll have to hold her every time. And every time you hold her, you'll be reminded, this is just about me.
I even get the feeling that it's a little bit worse.
For her?
For her.
Well, of course it's worse because she's sensitive to your emotion, so she feels an agreement inside of yourself towards anger with men. So she feels that you actually feel it's okay to be angry with men. But on top of that, she then gets overcloaked by some women spirits who are angry with men who then act out their anger with a man. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And so it does get worse for her for that reason.
I even thought about the law of attraction. They were talking about that maybe it's... Since I'm aware of it and I'm aware of what's happening,
mm-hmm.
that maybe it's getting stronger to increase the intensity of...
Exactly. This is something I wanted to talk about. This is how you engage things with God, you see. If we understand that we already have everything we truly need and then we start understanding, well, we can actually start addressing that and working through issues. So let's involve God in the process now. So here's God. So in this case, in your example that you've given... We've got God in this process. So the reality is, while you hold on to your addictions with men and expect men to do what you want and expect men to give you what you want and expect men to look after you and make you feel safe, right, which are those addictions that you know you have, then while you're holding on to that, you're going to try to imply the same addictions with the masculine side of God. So you want God to make you feel safe. You want God to make, you know, you want God to do all of the same things, right? Now, God's going to you going, no, this is not a loving relationship with me now. This is quite what I call an addiction, right? So here you are in this addiction, trying to have that addiction with God. Of course, God never responds to any addiction. So, of course, you give up trying to get it from God and instead you try to get it from men who will give it to you. Yes. So you even finish up marrying a man who will give it to you or having a partnership with a man who will give it to you, exactly the addiction that you want. Yeah? So now that you see that inside of yourself, you can start engaging actively with God, a dialogue through your feelings. You can go, okay, firstly, you already feel how much it's hurting your daughter. That's number one. So this is good. It's good for you to see how much an action inside of yourself is hurting somebody else. So very, very good. Very good first step, right? So we're now seeing, we're now aware of what is happening, and we don't want it to happen anymore because it's now happening to someone else other than yourself. You're starting to see the effect it's having on somebody else. So you're starting to actually see that if you don't take responsibility for the emotion you feel, your daughter will start acting it out and damage your son, who you also love. And so therefore you see the damage that's being done by the emotion living inside of you. So you're now feeling the damage. It's not just... you're starting to see now that it's not just you who's being affected by holding on to this men stuff. it's your daughter, your son, other people who you love are being affected by this particular problem. So now there's a growing desire in you as a result of that for you to change. Can you see? And this is what God wants. God wants this desire to grow so that you change. And so now we start developing a desire for change. So we see the hurt, we feel the hurt, now we desire change. This is very, very good. Because when you desire change, change can happen. If you don't desire change, no change can ever happen. Right? Now, you can engage a dialogue with God with your feelings. Right? You can actually begin to dialogue with God about how you feel about this issue, that you want to, instead of focusing on there, so every time you notice your daughter in a rage with your son and you hold her and she's expressing her rage and then she gets into her grief, while she's doing that, you could be praying to God, asking God to show you what you're afraid of and what grief you need to feel to work through the same issue. Does that make sense? And the beauty of that is that you'll often instantly be shown, or there'll be instant feelings that other spirits in the spirit world will give you that will show you exactly what the underlying cause is as to why you have that particular addiction. Yeah? Now, if you engage this dialogue with God, this dialogue that God can have with you, is that God can start informing you through a whole series of processes, some of which involve other spirits who are in a benevolent state, in a loving state, but some of which involves direct connection with you through your feelings. God can start telling you what you're afraid of, right? Because now you've gone through, you can see the hurt you're creating, you feel the hurt you're creating, you want to have change, so now God's got something to work with, right? Now God's got someone that wants to change. And God loves people who want to change, yes? It's easier for God to love a person who wants to change. And so what God does now is actually through this process, if you talk with God while it's happening, you'll find very rapidly you'll get the answers as to why the addiction exists inside of yourself that created the response in your daughter. Does that make sense? Yep. But if you just sit there and don't do anything with your daughter and let her hit your son, thinking that you're guilty and not her, which is what a lot of parents finish up doing, you are now teaching your daughter the same thing you were taught. You're teaching her that it's okay to control and hurt a male. Now, do you think that's a very good thing for her to learn as she's growing up? Obviously not, because sooner or later, she's going to have some pretty bad relationships if that's what she's creating. So, can you see you have to engage both processes at the same time? Yeah. Now, most of you ladies think you're good at multitasking. Yes? So you should be able to do that. It's just two processes at the same time. Should be able to do that. But it applies to men as well, by the way. So, yep. The beauty of engaging this dialogue with God is that you can ask God to bring you events today that show you what the problem is. You see? And when you think about it, if you were truly sincere to work through different issues, you would definitely want to do that, wouldn't you? You'd definitely want to know what they are. And so you'd want to have events that occur today. You see, what we spend a lot of our time doing with God and with events is we don't want anything bad to happen. How many of you feel like that? You only want nice things to happen, yes? Everyone's like that. We only want nice things to happen. So what happens is we avoid... So let's say this is not a nice thing happening that could happen in our life. What we try to do is we come along in our life and then we go, well, there's a potential of not a nice thing happening here. So what do you do with that? You detour. Right? And then it's the same when another not nice event potentially comes along. We avoid that one and avoid that one and avoid that one. Not understanding that these are opportunities to help us become more aware. Right? Now, if we were truly trusting God, what we would do is we'd say to God, so here's the person who's truly trusting God, we'd be saying to God, I want to know today, what's going on in this particular problem. I don't want to put it off for another week or another month or another year, another 10 years or all the rest of my life or until I die and hope that it's going to go away then, because to be frank with you, it is not. You will pass into the spirit world with exactly the same problem if you do not deal with it here on earth. That's the reality. There are no instant changes when a person passes into the spirit world. Not a single one. Right? So whatever problems you have when you leave here, you will have them as soon as you arrive there. Exactly the same problem. So if you don't have a relationship here and you say, oh, I'm going to put off not having a relationship, I'm going to put off the reasons why all of the rest of my life, I'm going to be single for the rest of my life, you'll arrive in the spirit world single and you still will not have a relationship, and potentially for hundreds of years, thousands of years, potentially, if you stay in that state. It's up to you, you see. So if you engage this dialogue with God, you'll be going, and you were sincere about wanting to change, you'll be going, I want to know right now what the problem is. And you would be trying to discover it already yourself, would you not, if you really wanted to know? You wouldn't be expecting anybody else to do the work for you. You'd be doing it yourself. Right? You wouldn't be waiting for someone to come along to tell you. You'd be wanting to know already yourself. So, and you'd engage a dialogue with God. Please let me know today. I want a law of attraction. If you can't communicate to me via my feelings, because quite often I'm pretty blocked, you know, I can feel that I'm blocked, then show me through the law that you have, this law of attraction. Show me through that what's happening with my life. Show me what the problem is that I've got with this issue today. I want to know. And if you're sincere about that request, you will always find out within the day. Often within the hour, very frequently within the next 10 minutes, you will find out. You will have a phone call, something happened, all sorts of things happen when you really have a strong desire. With myself and Mary often comment about how rapidly a request is made and the answer is given. Request is made, answer is given. And not always the answer you like, by the way, but it's given. Right? And God, that's how God works, if we're sincere. But we have to be sincere. You see, for many of us, we love our addictions and so therefore we become insincere. Right? We live in our emotional addiction. So in other words, our addiction might be control. So whenever God presents us with a situation where we could go, okay, I'm not going to control this and see what happens, what is your addiction saying at the same time? Control this, control this, control this. Right? And so you've got, on one hand, you've got the choice you could to not control, which is what God's offering you as an opportunity now in a particular situation. And then on the other hand, you've got the choice to control, which is coming from your addiction, demanding that it is satisfied. Right? And then you have the choice. Which one are you going to do? Are you going to satisfy the addiction? Or are you going to go, okay, this is my opportunity to give up control and see what happens? Right? Now, it takes a very brave person to do the second thing, if they've had a life of control. But what if the addiction is that you want to be liked? And if you go and tell somebody the truth, it means that there's a potential of you not being liked. Okay? Your best friend comes up, bought a new dress that she's just spent, how much? Like what's 1,000 kroner in US dollars? It's about 150, yeah. So let's say she spent 5,000 kroner on a dress. She comes up to you. She says, what do you think of my new dress? And you think she looks shocking. This is your opportunity. You're just getting presented with a law of attraction event to learn how to be honest. And how many of you go, you avoid the issue altogether? Or say, no, it's quite nice. That's quite nice. You know, or you try to soften the blow. Right? Or you try to, you know, you think about in that one situation, it's a tiny little situation, but it exposes huge amounts of issues, that one little situation. And yet we fall into the trap of meeting the addiction because we want her to like us. We want her to stay our friend. And if we tell her she looks terrible, she'll be angry with us for a week maybe. And we don't want to risk that. So let's go across there and then back.
I have some question about anger.
Mm-hmm.
I work as a counselor, and I'm used to have clients that have a lot of problem with guilt and shame, and they are not in contact with their anger,
mm-hmm.
and that's people control them because they suppress their anger, because to me, anger also can be an energy to take control of my own life. So could you talk more about that, things?
We've got to be very careful with anger from a healing perspective, because a lot of psychologists and other helpers of people with emotional difficulties believe that a person has to connect with their anger in order to heal. The reality is we do have to connect with our feelings in order to heal, and if one of our feelings happens to be anger, we do need to experience our anger. I agree. However, it is the dumping of our anger on another individual that I cannot agree with. Does that make sense?
Well, that's what we're doing in the treatment. They
exactly.
just get
they just feel anger and express their rage.
Yeah.
But they don't dump it on another person, another person.
That's not allowed.
Exactly.
They do it in the treatment to get in contact with their energy so they can take control of their life.
I agree. However, anger always covers an addiction.
Of course.
Always.
Yeah.
So if a person does get angry and they do not understand that an addiction is what's being covered by this anger, then there is a danger that they'll revert to anger every time they want to feel powerful.
We always get down to the grief.
Yep. And if you get down to the grief, then the grief releases and that anger also will disappear.
Yeah.
I agree. Yeah. However, for many people, that's not what happens even in therapy. I've seen many people in therapy for years and years and years who are encouraged to get into their anger, and they do get into their anger, but it's not what the addiction's about.
I have a lot of clients go in psychotherapy and so on, and they're just talking. And I say, we have to feel.
You do have to feel, yes.
Yeah.
I agree.
That's what I work with.
Yep, yeah. They have to feel. Yeah. You can't talk them through anything, really. They have to feel. I agree. But you need to be very careful with anger, because anger does cover addictions. For example, can I just give an example, perhaps? How many of you believe that you deserve to be loved? How many of you feel that? You deserve to be loved? Okay. So how many is that? That's about a third of the audience, is it? So deserve to be loved. So deserve to be loved is about one third of the audience, right? How many of you feel that if someone's not being loving to you, that it's just for you to feel angry with them? How many of you feel that? That you feel it's right for you to be angry with them if they don't love you? Many of you are not being honest now, see? If your husband or wife or partner today cheated on you, how many of you would be angry? Now we're getting more truthful, see? That was the question I just asked, reframed. Does that make sense? I just reframed the question, and now you connect to the event that causes it, and now you can start to see, yeah, I believe it. They deserve my anger. If they're in a relationship with me and they go and cheat on me, then they deserve to cop it from me. That's a belief, yes? How many of you feel that? It's okay to admit that we do, but more than half, okay. So maybe two-thirds. So if we're cheated on, then anger is a deserved response. Now, to be frank with you, I believe 90% of the people, or 100%, I feel most of the people in the world would agree with you, to be frank. So two-thirds. And the other one-third are possibly not being honest. Okay. So the question we have then is, if these are the beliefs that we have, then can you see there are specific addictions involved in these particular beliefs? How many of you would feel terrible if not one person in the world loved you? Let's say not a single person in the world loved you. How would you feel? Terrible? Okay, so that's a lot. That's pretty much everyone. Okay. When you are at one with God, you will not need to have the love of a single individual in the universe other than God. In other words, you can live in a world where there is absolutely no love for you and still be happy. Any other state is a state of addiction. Interesting. So in other words, what I've just said to you is that the third question I just asked, that, you know, about the love, is that every one of you has an addictive belief about love. That's what I've just said, really. Right. That's pretty confronting, isn't it? Yeah. And I can understand if the majority of you feel that I'm totally off now. Because the reality is, this is the world's belief. The world's belief is that that if we're not loved, we're worthless. But that's not God's belief, you see. God's belief is that even if nobody else loves you, from God's perspective, you are still worthy of God's love. You are still loved, in fact. Right? The problem that we have is we often don't feel God's love. And because we don't feel God's love, we need substitutes for it so that we feel loved. You see, once you're in at one condition with God, in a loving relationship with God, and you're at one with God, you will feel completely loved, and therefore you will not need the love of another person. You will still like it when they love you, but you won't need it. You won't feel unhappy if you don't have it. Does that make sense? That's where we're going for. That's the perfect situation. Imagine how comfortable you'd be with your life if not a single person in the world loved you, but you still felt loved. You'd be pretty comfortable with your life then, wouldn't you? Can you see that? Any other state, I'm saying, involves an addiction of some kind. So that's really saying that all of us have some addictions with love. And the reality is we do. The reality is, with all of these questions that I've asked, there are some addictions involved that we have, where we believe love to be one thing, when actually it's something completely different, right? And this is telling us that we live in our addictions frequently without even knowing. We even think that our addictions are true. We believe that we deserve love from somebody else. We believe that we should be able to get angry when we're not loved. We believe that. We believe that if nobody loves us, that it's the end of our world. Right? Not understanding that there is still one person who loves us, even if nobody else does, and that is God, your maker. And in fact, when you enter that relationship with God, you have the greatest capacity to grow, the greatest capacity to change, the greatest capacity to love others, and the greatest capacity to be happy. But we forget all of that, and we substitute relationships instead. So what we do is, because we can't feel God, we then try to find a substitute on earth or in the spirit world for that relationship. And what I'm saying is, the law of attraction will bring us these events that show us that our belief systems about love are false. So how many of you have ever been in a relationship and had that person leave you while you still loved them? So a good over a half. Now that tells me, and how did you respond to that? Most of you respond with sadness, yes? You grieved, yes? Well, the reality is you were grieving because you had a false belief about love. Right? And even now you don't agree with that. But the reality is that if you had the right view of love in your soul, you would never have grieved them leaving you. You could allow them to leave you without grieving. Does that make sense? Yep. And the reason why is because you wouldn't have taken it personally. You see, the reason why we grieve a lot of things is because we take the things very personally. We feel it's a comment about our worth. Do you see? We feel they're making a personal comment about our personal worth. And we have a lot of issues with our worth, a lot of unhealed emotions about our worth, and so we grieve. These are all law of attraction events that show us that love is the problem, you see? But you see, on the earth, what we do is we have these viewpoints that, you know, of love. So what are the viewpoints of love that we have? We have to question them. Because every single time pain comes, we need to see that pain is always the result of an unloving belief, not a loving one. So this is where we often feel very confronted, because we go, but I loved the person. Surely I'm allowed to grieve them. I'm saying, of course you're allowed to grieve them. You're allowed to do anything you want. But what I'm saying is the reason why you're grieving is because you have a false belief about love, that the grief will hopefully let go of some of it. There's false beliefs about love that exist. And God, like I said, is trying to get us out of denial. And to be frank, most of the things we deny are about love. We have a lot of belief systems about, as a parent, what we should do with our children. What's the loving thing? And a lot of what we do with our children is not very loving. And if you were on the receiving end of it as an adult, you wouldn't feel very loved either in many cases, right? But we do it because society believes that that's what love does, right? Like, I've heard so many people say to me, his mum's involved in his life all the time because she loves him. No, his mum's involved in his life all the time because she's in addiction with him. Right? The reality is we wouldn't be ever involved in our own child's life unless our own child wanted us to be involved in their life. And even then, if they did and it was an addiction on their part, we wouldn't get involved if we truly loved them. So, you know, there's so many problems we have with this issue of love. So what I would like for you to consider with the law of attraction is this. And I suppose you could summarise everything we've discussed over the last couple of days about the law of attraction is this. God wants us to know love. And what I mean by know love is whenever we know something, to truly know it, you must experience it. Is that not true? So God wants us to experience love, and thereby, by experience what true love is, we will come to know what it is. We'll come to recognize it. God wants us to know that. This law of attraction that affects our soul was created, this law, the law, laws was, to show us love. That's the purpose of the law. How does it do that? It's very simple. It provides remember we referred to this term yesterday, a feedback system. In that, if the event we've attracted is painful in its nature, then it's demonstrating the lack of love in our soul that created the event on some level. And if the event that happens is loving in its nature, there will be a positive, it'll be a positive event creating happiness for our soul. That's the basic feedback system that God's created. So when I get sick, am I happy? Usually we're miserable, aren't we, when we're sick, right? So that's telling me that there was something that was unloving that created my sickness, a belief inside of me, some kind of emotion inside of me that has created my sickness. and I can find it. And if I just feel my feelings while I'm sick, there's a good chance that I'll actually find it through that process. And the feedback system is telling me that it's an issue about love. And it's not just an issue about when other people didn't love me. Because, to be frank, that's only like one little part of our problem. Because the bigger part of our problem is when we do not love other people. That's the issue that's really being focused on. Or when we do not love ourselves, which is another big issue that we face. So if you look at the different loves that we need to eventually learn about, if you look at the different types of love, in terms of the priority of what we need to learn, in terms of what's going to bring us the greatest happiness, if we learn firstly about the love of God, then we learn next about the love of self, and then we learn next about the love of others, we will end up being a completely loving individual. We will end up understanding and experiencing love in all of its different forms. Right? Now, when I use self, self involves two parts. It means loving my half of the soul, right? And also means my other half, which is often what in Australia they call our wife or our husband. The other half of my soul, my soulmate. So that's what I mean by learning to love ourselves. We need to learn to love ourselves, not just ourselves, but the other half of ourselves. So in my case, I need to learn to love the feminine half of myself, right? Which is a different person, expressed in a different person than me, but we are one person expressed in two expressions, the masculine and the feminine side of it, and I need to learn to love both. Right? Now, the law of attraction has been created on that operates upon the soul. Remember I said yesterday that there are law of attractions that operate on all physical matter? So things like magnetism and gravity are all parts of the law of attraction as well. But they are operating on matter, not just... Whereas what I've been focusing on this discussion is the parts of the law of attraction that operate upon the soul, the real you. And this part that operates upon the soul is trying to teach us how to love in all of the possible ways we can love, not just on a selected part that you want to love, but rather in all the possible ways. So many of us are prepared to love ourselves, perhaps. Many of us are prepared to love others, but we're not prepared to love the other half of ourselves, some of us. And that's why we've never met our soulmate, because we're not yet prepared to love the other half of ourselves. Many of us are prepared to love ourselves but not love others at all. In other words, we're prepared to, you know, treat others badly or treat others unethically. In other words, we treat others in a manner that we would not treat ourselves. Right? Many of us are prepared to do that. Very few of us have a sincere desire for God's love and to enter a relationship of loving God. But we have, that is the one that is going to bring us the most happiness. Right? But if you put all of those things together, can you imagine what kind of a rounded out, happy individual you'll be? Because you'll end up feeling, firstly, that no matter what anybody else thinks about you, you can love yourself. No matter what anybody else attacks you and how whatever they do towards you, you'll still love yourself. You won't feel bad about yourself. Whatever anybody thinks about you and what you're doing with your life, you'll still love yourself and you'll still engage that particular thing that you want to do when it's in harmony with love. You'll always follow your desires and your passions. You'll never run away from your desires and passions because of what somebody else wants. You'll always engage your desires and passions because you've brought all of your desires and passions into harmony with love. So why would you not do them? Right? You'll always do that. And in addition, you experience the love of God, which transforms your soul into a new creature. So you've got this great ability to continue growing from infinitely. And then on top of that, everyone else is going to benefit from your expression of their love to them. you're going to probably finish up having quite a lot of friends, yes? If you love that way. Yeah? Because everyone's sort of attracted to that sooner or later. And even when you're being truthful with them, they still feel attracted to it, don't they? You tell them the truth, even though you know they initially react, sooner or later they're attracted to come back to get some more truth because they know you love them. They know that it's delivered in love, and they also know and respect that you have a desire to, you know, help them with their life and so forth. Now, if you think about the law of attraction as this is what God is teaching me, if I engage this law in an active, positive manner, instead of viewing it as, oh, there's a law of attraction again, you know, like what's going on, instead of viewing it like that, and instead of going, oh, you know, it's been another terrible day for my law of attraction, I hear many people say that, and I go, whose law of attraction again was it? God's. So how can it be a terrible day? Like, God's showing you a heap of things through this day, and your soul is being exposed in its condition this day. Isn't that wonderful? It's a great law of attraction. It's not a terrible one. And everyone goes, oh, boy, I had such a hard day today. That's fine. You might have had a hard day today. We only have hard days because we've got so many addictions to work our way through, and sooner or later they're going to get exposed, right? So we're going to have hard days. But when we say, oh, I've just got a terrible law of attraction, no, you haven't. It's God's law of attraction, and it's never terrible. Right? It exposes everything. It helps you grow in every possible way. You can change completely. You can change everything as long as you release the actual underlying reasons why you have it. So what I'd love to encourage you to do is when you think about what's happening to you each and every day is to remind yourself that God is trying to teach you how to love. And God's trying to teach you how to love yourself. God's trying to teach you how to love the other half of yourself. God's trying to teach you how to love others. And then God is also asking, if you wish to engage it, whether you would like to enter a relationship where you finish up loving God. But you don't have to. But God's asking you to engage that as well if you want. And God's constantly trying to open you up in some manner to help you engage that relationship. Now, if you went through each day like that, then the events that happened, you would want to take notice of them, wouldn't you? Rather than going, oh, you know, I don't want that to happen, I don't want this to happen, and yeah, let's deny that that even happened. You wouldn't do any of those things, would you? You'd be constantly engaged in an active way in your own life. You'd be constantly connected with what's going on as an individual in your own life. You wouldn't be trying to avoid your own life in any way. Right? And because of that, your life will change. And it cannot but change to become happier if you do that. Because every time more love is involved in your life, you will have more happiness. It's a subsequent result of love. Yeah. So hopefully, I'd like to finish the discussion there if I can. And what we'd like to do now is have a break for about 40 minutes if we can. And if we come back about 3:30, and then I'd love to just answer your general questions. It can be about this subject or any other subject that you'd like to ask the questions for. And we'll have two about 5:30 or so for you to engage that process with me if you wish. Okay? Pleasure.